Hey everyone, I'm back again with another video, and this one is a two-story video, so be sure to stick around for the second story as well. The first one is titled, Am I the A-hole for refusing to pay alimony to my cheating ex-wife? Please make sure you like the video and subscribe, and don't forget to hit the bell so you don't miss any of our future videos. Let's get right into it. I met my wife in my early 30s. She was in her mid-20s at the time. I was already well established and had made a significant amount of money working as a quant and investing my savings diligently. She, on the other hand, had never gone to college and was content to working for basically minimum wage. So when I meet her, we click instantly and I fall head over heels for her. We get married and move in together, and soon after we have 3 kids. When we were expecting our firstborn, she had told me she wanted to be a stay-at-home mom. Obviously, I was jealous, but I went along with it since it seemed logical. So, she spends the next 20 plus years as a stay-at-home mom taking care of our kids while I work 12 hours a day and then some. I'm not demeaning stay-at-home moms by any way, but in the context of our marriage, she had an extremely easygoing lifestyle. A couple of years ago, I discovered she had been cheating on me with her friend's husband. Divorce obviously followed. The only major asset we had in the US was our house, which was a premarital asset. We had a shared bank account, but since I am a finance guy, I handle all our investments, and for tax reasons, invested it abroad in my home country. Now, if we had just grown apart, or she said she was unhappy, I'd have no problem paying what's fair. But the fact that she cheated on me is what makes me resent paying her a cent. So, in the divorce, she's awarded half of our investments made during the marriage, more than 90% of which are abroad in my name, along with alimony for 20 years for 30% of my pay. So here I am given an opportunity to get out of this entirely by moving back to my home country and never looking back. So I sell our house as fast as possible, move the money abroad, and move back to my home country while stringing her along about why it's taking so long to liquidate our savings. Once abroad, I immediately stop alimony payments. Now, she has no legal recourse, I've double-checked with lawyers, and is left with her share of the small amount we had in the States. The reason I am asking here is that my own children are split on this. My son is on my side 100%, while my daughters are 90% on their mother's side. I figured it would be interesting to see the opinions of people here. And the first comment says, you are the a-hole, even if she cheated. This isn't about feelings at this point. This is about labor relations. The idea of alimony for the stay-at-home spouse is that they raised your kids, foregoing other work. It doesn't matter that she was working for minimum wage. She gave up opportunities once you had the kids. She didn't save for retirement, because if someone is a primary caregiver, the idea is that the spouse who works outside the home takes care of retirement. Now that the marriage is over, alimony fulfills your obligation to pay for her half of the labor of raising the children you also wanted. And a reply to that says, yeah, who's going to hire a woman in her 40s or 50s who hasn't worked in 20 years? Even working minimum wage jobs, she could have still worked her way up to management positions while also saving for retirement and paying into SSI. She gave up a lot to raise those kids. Daycare cost a ton and likely would have had the most cost or all of the amount she was working for, while she'd still be expected to cook and clean. The only benefit would be that if she was paying into SSI, she shouldn't have cheated, but she's well and truly effed. Edit to add, if it's not clear, you are the a-hole, and thanks to whoever gave me silver. And another commenter says, it's her fault for cheating. And the next comment says, she didn't raise his kids, she raised their kids. He did just as much for those kids as she did. She doesn't deserve money for parenting the kids she also decided to have. He put bread on the table, that should be payment enough. If we are gonna reimburse her for raising kids she also wanted, is she gonna reimburse him for the money he spent on those kids? It's generally a dumb rule. Plus, she cheated. She cheated while he was putting bread on that table. She doesn't deserve a cent. And the next comment says, even nannies who get room and board get wages. He's responsible for 50% of the money and labor for raising the kids, and she's responsible for 50%. She paid her half in labor, and he paid his half in cash. She's getting her half of what it takes to retire. She already earned that money. It's just that in a divorce, that labor gets turned into cash instead of a shared home and retirement. and the second story is titled, Never Understand How My Ex-Girlfriend Can Treat Cheating as a Normal Thing. Let's get right into it. So, my D-Day was around 7 months ago. I met my ex-girlfriend in 2014, and we made it official in 2015. I found that she suddenly deactivated her Instagram account without telling me in late 2019, and I only found out when I tried to forward a post to her and I couldn't find her account. When I confronted her, she told me that she did it because she felt harassed by her work friend's friend, let's call him X, that has been tagging her and kept trying to hit on her. I've known about this ex since a couple of months prior when we went to a social gathering on one of my ex's work events prior to COVID. I told X that I will be speaking to X to tell him to back off. However, X stopped me from doing that and said that it's not worth it, and X didn't want to create a drama among her work friends, so I relent. Then COVID happened, and in March, my ex-girlfriend told me that she'd been laid off and needed to move back to her hometown due to the lack of funds, and I was not able to help her that time because I was in the middle of renovating my home. I paid her rent and bills when she first moved to my city and haven't found work. My ex-girlfriend refused to move in with me because I lived in the suburbs and her old place was in the city center. We live 50 minutes apart. So we were apart for a few months until May, when I had finished renovating and had some funds to help her pay her apartment. While we were apart, I find her to be quite distant and cold. She went out often, despite COVID, and still awake in odd hours like 3 a.m. or 4 a.m. At first, I dismissed my thoughts because I thought she was depressed and stressed, but these activities continued even after she went back to her town. One day, I was hanging at her place when she was taking a bath, and her phone was blasted with chats. So out of curiosity, I opened her chat to see who she's chatting with, and I found a barrage of pictures from X being sent to her, with a text saying, I can't wait to see you tomorrow. My body went numb, and my mind went blank. I was fuming, so I tracked back to her previous chats with X, and I found out they have been exchanging pictures since 2019. I took pictures of the chats and whatever pictures they sent, then I told her I had an emergency issue at work that I needed to attend. I work in the medical field, so she knows sometimes I am needed in a certain situation. When I got back, I cried like a little baby, part of me thinking that I should fight for her, part of me just hurt, real hurt. You see, my previous relationship also ended with me getting cheated on, so experiencing it again really stings in the most hurtful place. In the morning, I opened my chats with her to see all our previous chats. I opened our pictures together, trying to find a reason not to throw this relationship away, until I stumbled upon our Instagram chats. I never deleted my chats with her. Lo and behold, her IG was profile picture was there, but I couldn't find or open her profile. Then it clicked, she blocked me. This woman had blocked me on her Instagram with a guise of deactivating her Instagram. I made another account to stalk her Instagram, and yes, her IG was active and was not put into private. I saw all her pictures, all her parties, stories, and yes, lovely picture of her kissing X in the mouth, which was taken not too long ago. Something snapped in me, and I was no longer feeling sad. All I felt was indifferent. I took pictures of her Instagram and deleted everything I had about her on my phone, laptop, everything. I sent her a text asking her to meet up, and when we met, I just showed her the pictures I took on her phone and Instagram. Straight told her that we're done. I don't know her anymore, and I don't owe her anything, then left. I blocked her everywhere that had me connected to her, told my parents and relatives to ignore her calls. Couldn't ghosted her because she knows where I live and work, so I just went no contact and I went hard. Mutual friends trying to get me to forgive, but I told them to stop contacting me about her or I will block them as well, so they back off after that. The reason I rant here was because last Valentine's Day I got a text from her, switched from Android to Apple, and I only blocked her on my old phone. Not on my new one yet, where she, with all her audacity, asked for me to help pay her rent. No, sorry, not trying to explain things. Didn't bother to respond and blocked her again straight away. I just wondered how the hell did I fall in love with someone who didn't feel any remorse or guilt after cheating on me. If you're still here, thank you for reading my rant. 1. Our mutual friends honestly didn't know about what my ex did, because they were blocked as well. I did manage to explain to them about the reason I broke up with my ex during a Christmas Zoom call. They understood and didn't mention her anymore after that, so I am good with that. One of my closest friends told me they wanted us to make up because they saw how happy I was when I was with her. So when I told him what my ex did, he almost went ballistic at her. I told him to drop it, since I want to avoid any drama. All in all, I'm just fortunate that my ex didn't reach out to my family. They were a different story I would like to avoid. 2. Some asked about the Instagram. I have to admit that I am so suckish and ignorant at social media things. I only know how to like, follow, comment, and post on Instagram, unlike my ex who's a heavy user of Instagram. So when she said she deactivated her account, I believed her completely. 3. Some of you commented about me paying her rent and being an ATM, which I admitted I was, and it was my fault since the beginning. The comment hit me hard, but it's the hard truth I needed. I tried too hard, I guess, and I really want to make this relationship work that somehow I'm blinded. I told myself that I will be her provider anyway when we get married, so it's okay for me to help her when she needs my help. Well, somehow I managed to dodge the bullet unintentionally, so I guess that's a win for me. And the OP has another edit for us. I woke up and find so many encouragement and questions. Frankly, I am truly grateful to this community for their massive support. I'd also like to thank you all for the awards. Hopefully happiness will find you all. Meanwhile, I will try to respond to some inquiries and questions from some of you. 1. What was my ex's response and excuses when I broke up with her? I didn't stay to hear her excuses, nor I was in a position where I want to know. All I had in my mind was to end it and leave. Whatever she said will never change the fact that she had broken my trust and had an affair. No explanation will fix or change that fact. 2. How did she know my number on a new phone? I retained my old number, been using it for 10 years or so, when I switched from the Xperia to my Apple SE. She texted me through regular SMS because I had her blocked on my WhatsApp, and I had forgotten to block her number on my iOS because I had deleted her number previously. Somebody asked why I changed from Android to iOS. Well, it's because I wanted to try iPhone, I guess. 3. About her refusing to be moved in with me when she was laid off. I know it should have been a red flag, but at that time, I was trying not to be pushy about her moving in because I had thought that she might react badly if I insisted. She doesn't drive and depend on me or her friends to go from one place to another. And since I am mostly working, she told me that she won't be able to go out with her friends or have anything to do if she moved in with me. I was always non-confrontational, and she was the type who hates it when someone forces her to do something she doesn't want to. 4. About her trying to get me back, I don't know how to respond to this, to be honest. I don't know whether I am mentally prepared to see her again or caught off guard meeting her. This is the worst case scenario that could happen to me right now. 5. I can't ghost her for obvious reasons, house and work. Since I can't ghost her, I just really hope that she won't come to my house or workplace. After 7 months, I really hope she won't ever show up with her face again. Again, thank you for your support and encouragement. It really made my day and reminded me that all will get better. Thank you guys for watching. Please make sure you like the video and subscribe, and don't forget to hit the bell so you don't miss any of our future videos. And be sure to comment below what other subreddits you want me to cover.